Hey there, how you doing?
Welcome to another episode of On Books. This is Chris here. This week, I'll be talking about some of the differences between Paris and New York, raising children specifically, in this book that I just read, Bringing Up Bebe. If you've never heard of it, it's a child-rearing or parenting book, how do they say? How do you say? One of those, I suppose. And I've been reading parenting books, apparently, and I'm not expecting to have kids, well, not anytime soon, nor do I have a child. I'm just interested in reading this book, and it was fascinating. So I'm really excited to share with you some of the learnings, whether you are expecting or are you just a human being living in this planet. If you are going to Paris or if you love Parisian culture, this may also be fascinating to learn some of the huge differences that are impacting my thinking from reading this book. So, gonna share that with you. Like I said, this is On Books. If you've never read this book or any of the books on the podcast, that's fine. I am here to share with you some of the books that have really inspired me and really, maybe not my favorite books, but books that have changed my thinking or changed people around me's thinking, and I have questions and I want to explore that. So that's what this podcast is about, and welcome for coming. If you have any questions, I share my email. It's chris@on-books.com. You can tell me what you're thinking about the podcast, share it with me, let me know what's up. Any requests, I'm here for you. What drew me, a mid-30s single male living in New York City, to read a book that's ostensibly about an American woman discovering some of the wisdom of French parenting? So what brought me to this book? Well, about a year ago, I was complaining to one of my coworkers, Sarah Peck, about my image or how babies in America occur to me, how when you have a child, I was just coming back from Christmas break, and the child is the center of attention for the family. You'll have something like 8 or 9 people all doing, you know, eating and talking and conversing. The child cries. The child walks into the room. Everything stops. Something about this bothered me. The lack of identity that I fear from having a child and how everything then revolves around the child. And I'm sure to some extent that is the reality of it. I mean, obviously you're sharing this responsibility and this existence on this planet with this new child, this human being that you're bringing into the world. But to what extent does it then take away from my own identity? And this really was something that bothered me. And she mentioned this book to me. Specifically, she said, do you know there are other ways to raise your children? Other ways than just what you've seen here in America. And there's a line from the book that she quoted about identity in Bringing Up Bebe, talking about how the parent has to maintain the identity and not give it away to the child. At first, on page 188 here, the author, Pamela Druckman, writes, "The couple is the most important. It's the only thing that you choose in your life. Your children, you didn't choose. You choose your husband, so you're gonna make your life with him. So you have an interest in that going well. Especially when the children leave, you wanna get along with him." The author here is talking about one of her friends, and she says that her friend has no intention of letting her romantic life slacken just because she has 3 kids. That seemed like a pretty radical idea to me that Sarah was telling me about. You know, this idea that you can have your own identity, that you can maybe travel with your kids. A story from the book about a mother who takes a 10-day holiday alone with her husband every year, quoting, "It's non-negotiable." It just started opening my mind to other ways to raise kids than what I had seen, looking for better examples, which seems to be a theme of this podcast, looking to books for better examples or perhaps just alternative examples of how to live your life. And so that inspired me to say, hey, I'm going to maybe want to read this book, even though I'm not actually expecting children. And so I read it about a month ago. As soon as I finished, I really loved it. I went through it in about 4 or 5 days and emailed all 3 people that are pregnant in my life right now saying, have you heard of this book? You should read it. I emailed my friend Mike, who had recently told me he was pregnant, to which he responded in this email saying, wow, I love the fact that you're now reading baby books, even though you're not expecting. Or are you? No, I'm not. I think there may come a time in life when you can read too much. And perhaps we know now what that is. As your accountant, spiritual advisor, and physical trainer, not true, but perhaps, I suggest that you do no reading in the year 2017. I'm giving you a buffer since I know you can't go cold turkey. Okay, so Mike knows me pretty well, and we had this really great conversation. Am I reading too much by reading parenting books, even though I'm not expecting? Which led me to some interesting thoughts about the experience reading this book as someone not expecting. There have been so many times in my life that it's been compulsory to read books to study for college, read to get a job, and you prepare, right? I've spent so many years preparing as part of the culture to do certain events. But with children, why don't we prepare until 9 months before the child's going to come? That frightens the hell out of me to just think that, okay, you're pregnant, you have a little bit less than 9 months to study and figure out how this is going to happen. No license required. So, my dear friend, I'm here to deliver some of the highlights of what I learned reading this book. So, in my search to look for better examples, alternative examples to how we can raise children, you know, looking outside of New York City, I want you now to consider some of the learnings of how Parisian families raise their kids, and on some of the differences between Paris and New York City, as written by Pamela Druckman in this book, of course, bringing up Bebe. The first lesson I learned, the pause. A lot of my friends that are having kids are really tired. They're exhausted, and they tell me that they have to wake up during the night many times when the baby cries, if there's something wrong with the baby, if the baby's hungry, all this kind of stuff. I don't know anything about that. I don't have any kids, but it scares me to just think about how tired they are. And it seems like a battle. Pamela Druckman, the author, felt the same way and had a similar kind of worry. And when she got to France before having her baby, she noticed that the French mothers, the kids were sleeping through the night. They were doing their nights, as they were saying. And she's like, what? How are your kids sleeping through the night? You know, and my newborn child isn't. Why is there a difference? And so in her investigation, she discovered that French parents do something that she refers to as the pause. Put simply, babies are noisy sleepers. Given that they're noisy sleepers, they move around with their arms, they make a lot of noise. That doesn't necessarily mean that they're awake just because they're making noise. So the pause is this practice of, if the child's making noise, give it 5 minutes to cry it out, basically. And then after 5 minutes, you know, if they're still crying, then maybe they actually need something. The idea is that if after the first 2 months, you can do this, the baby will learn to sleep on his own, his or her own. I found it fascinating also, she mentions that adults, that we wake up during our sleep cycles too, but that we don't remember this because we've learned to plunge into the next ones. And this has made sense. I used to have a Fitbit, and you could see that you have the REM sleep cycles, right? And they last for something like, I'm kind of estimating here, three or four hours or something. And then you do have the break. And I'm guessing that's what she's referring to, is this idea that we do have that, but we just sleep right through it. And she encourages, through a study of the French mothers, that if you give the baby a chance to self-soothe, you don't automatically respond every time, that it will learn it itself. The idea of the pause is introduced early in the book, and it began to just open my mind to consider, oh, this is so interesting that there's a different way to do this. And as many of the readers of this book, if you look at the Amazon reviews and you talk to people about it, you definitely have that moment in the first 20 pages. If you've ever known any really tired parents, or if you've been one where you're like, oh, well, what else is there? And that's what Pamela Druckman asks. She's like, well, if there's this, what else can I, you know, go deeper into? The second lesson I learned is the importance of maintaining identity separate from your children. So I mentioned earlier already that this was one of the main things that drew me into the book. It's, you know, how do I, Chris, maintain being Chris without giving myself fully, you know, 120%? Where's the piece of me? Does that disappear? I had these questions. And she goes into that. She has this account of a friend of hers who is from France and living in America. So the opposite of her situation, the opposite of the author's situation. And her French friend living in America remarks about Thanksgiving dinner in America and what that's like. And I can really relate to this. So she writes, at a big Thanksgiving with her husband, she was astonished to see when a three-year-old arrived. All 20 people at the table, they stopped talking to focus on the child. And I thought, this is incredible. This culture, it treats the kid like a god. Look, I don't know enough about psychology, and I clearly don't have a kid, but I know this experience of what it's like to treat the child like a god. And maybe to some extent there is value in that. I mean, maybe to some extent, you know, walking into a child's home now and seeing the 20 to 30 blinking, yelling toys, not yelling, but kind of like, bah! To me, they're yelling. They're like, ah, rah, rah. You know, all the toys that they have and all the, you know, my two-year-old nephew has an iPad already. Jeez, right? And to see all of this attention and noise and what does that mean? And this book really dove deep into some alternatives and made me think, you know, that's not the only way to raise a kid. For, you know, hundreds of thousands of years, we had people being born on this planet, and you weren't a bad mother if you didn't give your kid an iPad. So there's other ways to be. One of the French mothers in the book, that she goes on a picnic. They go on a picnic together. And for the whole day, the French mother brings the toy that she brings. It's just a tiny ball, one ball for the child for the whole day. Really palpable, really made me think. Next, I got a few more tips and lessons that I learned. I was really surprised how wide the children's palate is, how much they were willing to eat. And, you know, eating collard greens and liver as a child. Pamela Druckman writes, there is no such thing as kids' food in France, on page 206. She suggests that if a baby rejects food, parents should wait a few days and offer the same food again. The conversation beyond food can also go beyond, I like it, or I don't like it, suggesting that, you know, here's a vegetable, and asking, is it crunchy? Does it make a sound? What does this remind you of? What does it feel like in your mouth? So the French, as she suggests, are trying to awaken your senses rather than just this kind of Facebook binary, do you like it or do you not like it? How do the French get their children to eat so many different foods at such a young age? And she comes across a woman named Fanny who has a rule that her child Lucy has to taste everything on the plate. She doesn't have to eat all of it, but she has to take one taste of all the foods. And they also, in the daycare, have different courses for the kids, so they get the opportunity at a young age to taste so many different foods. This is probably good advice for me even as an adult. The differences between France and New York City when raising kids. So in France, daycare is free. The government subsidizes it, which was fascinating to learn about. In France, the children books, there aren't any bad guys and good guys, she writes. Life is ambiguous and complicated. Whereas in the English books, there seems to be a problem and a solution in every book. And the prosperity, it must be around the corner. And finally, one last lesson I'm going to share with you. I was really surprised about the meaning of the word bonjour in France. I mean, not only that it means hello, obvious, but the fact that in France, there are four magic words, as Pamela refers to it. Do you know what they are? Could you guess what the four magic words are? Well, if you're listening in America, what do you say to children are the two magic words? You say please and thank you. You must always say please and thank you. Well, in France, there are four magic words. There's please and thank you. And there's also hello and goodbye. Please and thank you, they're necessary, but they're not sufficient enough. So the author writes, I hadn't realized that learning to say bonjour is a central part of becoming French. She goes on to write, I think tourists are often treated gruffly in Parisian cities and shops, partly because they aren't beginning interactions with bonjour, even if they switch to English afterwards. It's crucial to say bonjour upon, and here's take a few notes, upon climbing into a taxi, when a waitress first approaches you at a table in a restaurant, or asking a salesperson what size these pants come in. So saying bonjour acknowledges the other person. It acknowledges that they're a human being, their humanity, and that's a really important part of French culture. That's another episode of On Books. So thanks again. This was Bringing Up Bebe by Pamela Druckman. If you like On Books, you can let me know. I'm chris@on-books.com. At that website, on-books.com, which is my website, I have book notes. So a lot of the quotes that I put on here with the page numbers, all that kind of stuff, any extra links of things that I might have mentioned are going to be on there. You can check it out. Please subscribe on iTunes if you like the show. I'd love it if you told a friend about it. If you tell a friend, email me and let me know that you told a friend. If you're hesitant by telling a friend because of anything that you're thinking, let me know why. Do I talk too much? Do I not consider books that you want to read? These are all books that are really important to me. I think books are a huge part of our culture and education, and I'm just so excited to keep doing this and bring you more. So let me know. I'm also on Twitter and Facebook, where you can get the latest updates about the show and things related to the show. That's at On Books Show and facebook.com/onbooksshow. My name is Chris Castiglione. Some of this music is from Birdstar. Previous episodes of On Books cover books such as The First 20 Hours, Sex at Dawn, Midi in Captivity, Letters of a Young Poet. Those are all free. You can get those on iTunes and on my website. So do it. Keep reading, and I'm looking forward to seeing you next week. Au revoir. I've